want to bring someone else in as well, and you're going to be on the line too, so you can both talk to each other as well. Rupert Sutton is here from, he's a research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society. Good afternoon, Rupert.
Good afternoon.
Rupert, how widespread is this, what David just been speaking about in this one particular mosque? Do you think this is a problem that plays out across the communities across the country?
Well, I think that's one of the key takeaways, actually, from this case is that there does seem to be, unfortunately, a culture of impunity almost across the country on this issue. As David mentioned, we saw there's at least one other mosque in London that's already under investigation for this. But earlier this year, I also spoke to people about a case where clerics were being invited overseas to come speak at a mosque in Luton, in this case, who had a long history of inciting violence against blasphemers, had been cited by Mumtaz Qadri as an inspiration for him killing Salman Taseer, and was able to come and speak at the mosque without any challenge. It was almost, I think, as if people didn't realise it was happening. And people at this mosque were posting pictures of themselves with him, were talking about the very issue about support for Mumtaz Qadri, and nothing came of it. So I think that is very much a sign, along with these leaflets, that people feel they can hand this material out, they can invite these speakers, and they won't face any consequences.
Rupert, there's a current controversy of an Islamist cleric who's received a visa to come to the UK, but he's been caught on video preaching that he believes that LGBTs should be executed. Do you think there's grounds to, not provide visas to people that hold these views?
Certainly, I think that the Home Office does have the power to prevent people from entering the country if they believe there is some kind of threat to public safety, and it's certainly something that they've done before, both with Islamist clerics, but also with far-right and anti-Muslim ideologues. So certainly that power is there, and I think that there is a good argument in a number of cases for using it. But I think what's also important is that we look at organisations within Muslim communities as well as other community groups, which are trying to highlight this issue and trying to get people to understand. When you invite people like this, you are essentially alienating and victimising a whole section of the community, and that actually it would be better if this speaker wasn't invited in the first place, so these decisions don't have to be made. Now, I believe I've seen something just within the last hour or so suggesting that discussions where I think at least one institution where this individual that you mentioned had been invited had been ongoing about the hurt and about the damage that this had caused. And I think that's the best way that we can work on this, is getting communities to understand that it's best if they're not invited in the first place.
Okay, David, last question to you. The fact that the source came forward to you and gave you this story, does that fill you with hope that there are people in the community who are prepared to speak out against this sort of stuff?
I think so, yeah. I mean, I think the reason why, they were taking it quite seriously, the subject matter of the booklet, and why, indeed, the police are taking it seriously, I think the worry is that, the views expressed in this kind of literature, there's a risk and a danger that it does create an environment where people think that, in some cases, violence can be acceptable. And, of course, we know that it's not.
David Churchill, Evening Standard reporter who broke that story yesterday, and Rupert Sutton, research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society. Thank you very much.